Welcome to another addictive episode of the Ocean Sailing Podcast with your host and sailing addict, David Howes.
Hey folks, welcome to episode 93 of the Ocean Sailing Podcast. This week we're talking to Mark Chu from Melbourne, who's got a fascinating background from getting started in ocean racing as a teenager, competing in some of the Australian Blue Water Classics, joining the wooden boat community 25 years ago with the purchase of a 1964 Sparkman and Stevens yacht called Cotton Blossom. And then later on, he went on to purchase a yacht called Fairwinds. It's a 1956 Philip Rhodes design from Auckland in New Zealand. And it's just a really great, I guess, fireside chat with Mark, who's crossed the Tasman three times. He sailed up and down the east coast of Australia, done all sorts of local club racing, been across Bass Strait a number of times in various events and races, sailed around the Pacific Islands. And then he was also 10 years, I think, as a president of the Classic Yacht Association of Australia. And so shares some great insights on his love for boats, his love for wooden boats, his love for classic design, and then some of the thoughts around the camaraderie that develops when you sail with a regular crew and the years and the decades go by and the bond that you form. That really shapes a part of your life as almost a second family, really, or an ocean family. So it was a great chat with Mark, and I think you'll find lots of insights, lots of thoughts that strike a chord with you, particularly if you're a cruising sailor or a club racing sailor and looking to develop and build what you do. So enjoy this week's episode with Mark Chu.
G'day, Mark.
So where are you?
I'm just on the Gold Coast in Currumbin.
I'm in the Australian Wuhan down in Melbourne.
By the drink, yeah. Well, that's good. Cool. Well, it's fortunate to meet you, and just by way of chance, with Kylie giving me a call out of the blue, she was driving down the highway or something, listening to the podcast. So
that's right, yeah.
So thanks, Mark, for agreeing to appear on the Ocean Sailing Podcast. Why don't you tell me about your story? I just thought, my goodness, there's so many chapters to it. I mean, you're like me, you've got a bit of silver hair now, and you've got a few stories, and I'm sure you've got a few battle scars as well.
Yeah, a few scars. My sort of sailing story, I suppose, is what you're really interested in. I don't think it's particularly special. I'm a little bit intrigued that you sort of feel like I'm worth talking to, but I didn't really get into sailing until sort of late teenage years, you know, till probably sort of 18 or 19. And it's quite interesting because, you know, often when you hear about elite sailors and, you know, they do say that if you didn't sail as a kid, you know, like sail seriously, then you can get to a high level, but you can't get to the really top level of sailing. And I think that's absolutely true. You know, like I'm very competent on a boat and I feel very comfortable and, you know, I can win my fair share of things, but I'm never going to be a great sailor without having done the really early sailing. So I think that's an interesting thing to start off with. And I got into it via windsurfing in those days. So we're talking sort of late 80s, early 90s, doing a lot of windsurfing and basically getting bored, going out and back, out and back, out and back. And then I thought I'd actually like to go somewhere. So I went into a yacht club on a Wednesday afternoon. That's the Royal Melbourne Yacht Squadron. And their races started about sort of 6:15 in the summer. And I went into the bar and somebody said, come for a sail with us. And so you hop on board a boat. And in those days it was an SNS 30, a little Defiances, I think. Uh-huh. Just sailed on for a couple of years, and that was my first experience of sailing keel boats. We did a Melbourne Devonport race in a little 30-footer, which was my first offshore race, which is a sort of crazy thing to do in Bass Strait in the windy day. Yeah. But it was good. It was good. We made it and survived. And then that interest led me. In the meantime, I got married in the next couple of years, and my wife and I decided we wanted to get away from Australia for a while, and we went to England and we bought ourselves a little 30-footer in Plymouth, mm-hmm. a Moody 30, and we sailed that along the channel, and then we took the mast down and took it through the French canals for a year and ended up in in Corfu, and ended up getting a job running sailing holidays, like a flotilla sailing, which we did for a couple of years, being a sort of skipper running these flotillas. So that sort of got me into more of the boat handling side of things. Not so, again, not really so much racing. That was a fantastic experience. We met friends that are still friends today doing that. One of my close mates in New Zealand, who's a really good sailor, worked with us on the sailing holidays there. So that was a sort of a great experience, because you're running a flotilla of about 10 boats and you're on a lead boat and you're responsible for those 10 boats. And because it's flotilla sailing, they don't have to have the same level of experience as bareboat charter. So you get a lot of people who are relatively incompetent. And you're tying up usually against keys in little villages in Greece and stuff. So it can get pretty stressful and crowded trying to get your 10 boats in on the key with sort of, you know, stern anchors and all that sort of stuff. So it was a great experience for boat handling as well as being a lot of fun. So we did that for a couple of years and then came back to Australia. And that's when I started to get into sort of ocean racing seriously. And the first sort of boat that I got onto when I came back was a boat called Agro, which in those days, this is early 90s, was an Adams 12, which was sort of, I remember thinking what a massive boat it was. It was huge. It was a 40-footer.
Quite a skinny one too.
when you mean sailing a 30-footer or 40-footer, it was one of the bigger boats at the club. And the guy who owned it was quite experienced. He was a bit of a grumpy old guy. Hopefully isn't listening to this. He was a bloody good sailor.
Male sailors, so that's okay.
And we started doing some, you know, relatively serious offshore racing. And in fact, that sort of was geared towards the 50th Sydney Hobart. So that was in 1994. So that was our sort of big target to do that, which is still the biggest fleet that ever did the Sydney Hobart. I can't remember. I think it was up near 300 boats did it.
360 or 380 or some huge.
Was number. It over 300, was it?
Yeah, I remember looking at that.
I've got a picture of, I wonder whether this is going to work. Can I show you a picture? I know it doesn't really work for podcasts, but I'm going to show you.
Well, with the video version of this, which I'll put in the Facebook group, I'll better see whatever you show me.
So I'm going to just show you this picture here, which I'll hold up to the camera. Oh, yeah. There you go. So that's the first rounding mark, and we're actually right in the middle of that.
Wow. For those listening, the boats are probably 8 to 10 abreast going around the first rounding mark.
Yeah, and the mark was drifting.
One or two.
So we were all chasing the mark as it went. That's going out of Sydney Harbour and the 50th Sydney Hobart. And the mark was drifting, and all the boats were trying to chase and go around. It was a crazy day. But we ended up doing that Sydney Hobart. And of the 300 and whatever boats, over 200 of them were in performance handicap division. So we weren't in an IRC or IMS in those days, I guess it was, division. We sailed in performance and we won overall, which was really exciting. So we won the performance handicap division, which was a great achievement on, you know, what was then an old boat, and we pushed it super hard.
And big fleet. It's a huge fleet.
Yeah. That was a great achievement. That was sort of really satisfying. And we did other races, you know, we did all the Bass Strait races, King Island races and Burnie races and Apollo Bay races and Devonports and West Coaster. And the next year we did the West Coaster down the west coast of Tassie to Hobart, all on Agro. She'd done a lot of miles. She was a great boat. Have you ever sailed on Adams at all?
We've got I think it's an Adams 11.9 at the south of your club.
Yeah, right.
Really skinny, and no matter where you sit, it hurts because you're always landing on winches or fleets.
It's like an overgrown Adams 10.
Half of a twilight season for the owner, and you had to helm and do the running backstays and manage the main as well, and go around broad water marks where there's barely any water under the keel and try not to run aground. So it was a bit of a challenge, but fast boat upward.
Yeah, I think, you know, in terms of value for money for position in the fleet, if there's such a thing, I reckon an Adams 10 is still your best number today. Like, you can buy a really quick Adams 10 for $30,000.
Yeah.
And you can be beating modern 40 footers over the line. You know, they are seriously amazing boats. You know, there's a lot of downsides to them, like they're uncomfortable and, you know, a whole lot of other things. But in terms of actual speed, they're amazing. I think Joe Adams is one of the more underrated sort of designers around. So anyway, so we did the ocean racing, then started having a family. So ocean racing wasn't really a thing, you know, getting away for weeks at a time, doing that sort of thing. And so after a, probably about a couple of years, I bought my first sort of proper boat, not the boat we had in Europe, because that was only a little 30-foot plastic boat, but a proper boat. And it was a boat called Cotton Blossom, which is a S&S 40. It's still around here down in Melbourne. Designed 1964, Sparkman Stevens. Again, another skinny boat. This one was built in New Zealand by a guy, I don't remember his name, I think his name was called Max Carter in Auckland. And it was built of triple skin cowry, so it's sort of pretty much bulletproof and rock proof. It was a fantastic boat. I sort of almost regret selling it. but absolutely beautiful boat. A really traditional Sparkman Stevens design. Probably a bit of a forerunner to a Swan 38, which they built out of the first Swans out of fiberglass.
Right.
Very much along the same lines, slightly bigger. It's one of the first boats where they had the transom going the wrong way as opposed to the right way, you know, sort of cutaway transom. Before that, they were always the traditional way. And I love that boat. But as we were getting a family, it wasn't really, because it was so thin, there just really wasn't quite enough room on board.
Yeah.
So I had that for 2-3 years. And there was actually...
Before you jump on, I just ask you, so what made you choose that kind of classic style boat as opposed to a more modern plastic boat, production boat? What is that, something that it's just, you've always had a passion for?
No, not really. It's almost accidental. I mean, obviously, it's a really hard question to answer because I don't really have a good answer. I just sort of fell in love with it. You know, I didn't have a passion for wooden boats. I'm not a woodworker. I'm not a carpenter. I don't really know how to look after them, but I sort of do have I'm a photographer, so I have a sort of visual eye and I do like beautiful things. And I saw this boat and it was beautiful and I learned of the history and the S&S connection and stuff. And I sort of really wanted it. And it was more the coincidence of wanting that then led me into being involved with classic boats rather than thinking I want to be involved with classic boats and getting into it. It was sort of more the chance element of it. And so this was, let's say, mid-90s. So in a sense, you know, the boat was only 30 years old. Now, a 30-year-old boat nowadays is a 1990 boat, you know, so it wasn't as classic as you might think it is now. You know what I mean by that? Yeah. I mean, nowadays it's absolutely a classic, but you know, in those days it was really just an old boat, you know, and a beautiful old boat with it. So I didn't make a conscious decision to get into it as a sort of classic boat owner, but I did love the boat very much. And we sailed that. We did a couple of Bass Strait races in it. We did a Devonport race and we sailed it a lot in the classic fleet down in here in Melbourne. Not a lot of cruising. Again, I think it was probably because we had little kids at the time. So we had that for 3 or 4 years and then sold it to a guy who took it to Ireland. And it went to, I think it was an Australian who took it to Ireland and it went to live in Ireland for about 5 years and he brought it back. So it sort of traveled the world having been built in. It was built in Auckland for the Auckland Suva race in 1965. So it did the Auckland Suva.
It's still running today. It usually runs every couple of while. I think it goes to Auckland to dinner hour now, but still every couple of years.
Oh, right. Right. Squadrons. Yeah, very cool. So we had that boat for a couple of years, or more than that, probably 3 or 4 years, and then sort of upgraded only a little bit. But it probably relates to your question about what I was into by then, because we moved to a slightly more classic boat, but slightly bigger and beamier as well. So this is the boat that I've still got today and we've had for nearly 20 years, which is a boat called Fairwinds. And that's the original name. Fairwinds is designed by an American designer called Philip Rhodes. Philip Rhodes, in fact, Olin Stevens worked for Philip Rhodes. So he's a little bit older than Olin Stevens. And he was based in New York as well. And he was... I mean, he designed some famous racing boats. Probably the most famous is an America's Cup winning boat called Weatherly. And he also designed a boat called Carina, which I think won 3 Fastnet races, I think, which is in those days, sort of 1940s, you know, absolutely classic yawl. You know, so basically same sort of rig as Dorade Storm Weather or that sort of thing. Big mainmast, tiny little mizzenmast, and as a balancing sail at the back. So Carina was probably his most famous boat. And Fairwinds was designed as a yawl as well, at 43 foot. So I'd love her to be a yawl again one day, but she's not at the moment. She was a sloop before I bought her. So somebody took the mizzen off probably in the 70s, I think. Mm-hmm. And there's always this constant argument between people in classic yachts about whether it's worth having the mizzen or not. You know, some people say the only thing it's useful for is hanging on to while you're taking a pee off the back. Yeah. And other people sort of say, oh, no, it's the absolute sail. You've got to have it just for that last little bit of balance for the boat to sail itself. You know, it's definitely not a speed thing. It's more of a balance thing, having the mizzen at the back. Yeah, right. I'd like to put it back one day, but, you know, once you do that, then you've got a whole lot of other issues, like, you know, getting a new boom and a whole new set of sails and chain plates and mast steps and all that sort of thing. So it's not a small job. So getting back to fairwinds, 1956, there were six built to this design. Design number 633, which is Philip Rhodes' design number. He had them all itemized. There were six boats built, and I know of three in existence at the moment. One's in Spain, in Barcelona. One's in America, and one's in Australia, the three of them. Fairwinds was built, a lot of wooden boats by American designers were built in Germany after the war, I think, because labor was so cheap and the skill sets were there. So she was built by Abking Rasmussen, who are a famous shipyard in Lemwerder in Germany. And on completion was shipped to the west coast of the United States to the owner who'd ordered her. So although she was built in Europe originally, she'd never sailed there. So then she went out to the west coast to her owner. Do you want me just to keep playing on with the history? Is this boring you?
No, it's perfect. Just, yeah.
I love it, but I just worry that other people don't.
You'll love the detail. I actually love the detail. So don't feel you have to go fast.
Okay. Tell me if I'm boring you, please, because I'd hate to be that old guy who craps on about his old boat.
No, you'd be surprised. He'll love the stuff. And the irony is people assume that it's a race sometimes, but the most popular podcast episodes today, they've also been the longest, and they've been a couple of hours. So don't
push it all.
But just the concept of designing in the US, constructing in Germany, shipping it back to the US is fascinating even back then, you know, with what we take for granted today in terms of transportation. So much that must have involved to be able to do that.
It's really interesting. And actually, just a sort of sideline to that is, you know, whenever we're fixing stuff or replacing things on board, we've always got this sort of dilemma, because being an American design, obviously everything was imperial, but then it was built in Germany, so everything was metric. And then everything since then has either been in America or New Zealand or Australia. So the amount of different threads and dimensions and everything is just bizarre. You know, you don't have a consistency to it, but that
just... Yeah, I've got a just sold a South Carolina built Beneteau yacht that was 1992. And so I had the same dilemma, but some parts were designed in France, but it was built in the US. So I had to carry metric material for everything. There was no guarantee that anything was either or.
Yeah. And port can be one and starboard can be the other.
So I can...
Oh, good. You know the feeling, yeah. So Fairwinds was put on a boat, and I've got a picture of her on the transporter. The other boats that Abking Rasmussen used to build at the time, built some for Sparkman Stevens, but also the Concordia yawls. I don't know whether you know about Concordias. They're very powerful. They're gorgeous boats. I think there's about 80 or 90 of them built, and a lot of those were built in Germany and shipped out. So she's on this boat with a Concordia beside her, and they were obviously being built in the yard together. And originally she was built of oak frames with mahogany planking. Mm-hmm. And it's what they called... I really have to emphasize, I'm not a shipwright here. I know a little bit about construction boats, but I'm not the person who's going to tell you how things work particularly. But she was planked with what they call French carvel. So instead of carvel, where you're literally just putting one plank on top of another, French carvel is double layered, where they stagger them. So they actually two layers of plank that are offset.
Right.
Which is great for strength, but what it does have a problem is once you get water in between the two layers, because they put canvas in between the two layers, then it can wander around in between the two layers and go to somewhere where it didn't come in, and then you get rot problems and things like that. So she was French carvel with mahogany planking on these oak frames. And the first owner was a guy called Fleets, I think Thomas Fleets, and he was an Olympic Star Class sailor. So he went to the Olympic Sailing Star Class, but this was obviously his cruising boat. And he had it for a couple of years, only for 2 years from new. So, you know, he was obviously a wealthy man.
Yeah.
And then he sold it to the second owner, a guy called Rockwell. And he would be the longest owner. He had it for about 30 years.
Wow. That's a long
time. Yeah, he sailed it down through Panama, across to Europe, to the Med, back to the States, back through Panama, up to the West Coast, mm-hmm. and then eventually across the Pacific to New Zealand. Wow. So that was over 30 years. So, you know, it wasn't a while ago. So he owned it, and the family, when he died, there was an obituary and the family talked about the boat. And so it was obviously a big part of their family. And I suspect, I don't know this, but I suspect that when he got to New Zealand, he probably got a bit sick. I don't know whether, you know, some major sickness, because he set off to go back to the States and only got as far as the islands and then turned back and went to New Zealand. And eventually the boat was sold in New Zealand to the third owner. And this would have been in the sort of around 2000. And the owner in New Zealand only had the boat for a few years. And I bought her off him in 2001. I think so. I've been 19 years. So I'm the fourth owner in, she's 1956, so that's 44, that's 64 years. So the fourth owner in 64 years.
And so, you've had it for the second longest at, and they're 64.
Yeah, years. Yeah.
That's incredible.
It's a good story, yeah. It's a good story.
And, I mean, and we'll come to it next, because you've had some adventures and some travels in Fairwind since then. But I mean, what was the condition of the yacht when you purchased her, and what have you had to do initially along the way, and then where did you take it from in terms of when you've done some offshore stuff, you know, cruising wise and sailing and racing wise, and some, you know, East Coast Australian stuff. What you get to do? What have you done sales wise? What have you had to spend on the boat in terms of areas you're playing to? And
so when we bought her in New Zealand in 2001, she was in pretty good nick. She was quite original. She had the original decks and obviously the original hull and everything, and planking and frames were all there. And she must have been all right, because we sailed her back to Melbourne from Auckland without stopping, you know, so it's a decent trip. I think it was like 11 days or something to Melbourne.
Yeah.
And that was sort of our first big trip. I mean, we cruised her around the Gulf and things before to get used to it. And then we just headed off. And it was a great trip. We had quite a bit of wind, and she was a fantastic boat. One issue we did have is because the mizzen had been taken out, the boom was still the original length. So she was underpowered in the light stuff at the back of the boat. And anything under 10 knots, you'd get lee helm, which is just horrible, just absolutely horrible. You know, you're sailing. She's a tiller, so you've got a 43-foot boat with a tiller. So you got the tiller pushed away from you the whole time, because she wants to head off downwind all the time. You need more pressure at the back of the boat. So actually, when we got back to Melbourne, one of the first things we did was put a longer boom on her. We put a metre and a half extra boom on her, which, you know, in hindsight, that might have been the time to put the mizzen back in. But having bought the boat, probably didn't have the cash reserves to do that then. So we sailed her back to Melbourne, and we had a fantastic trip. I think we were five up. We sort of generally, she doesn't have any auto helm at all. She's never had any auto helm or self-steering gear, so we steer her the whole way. If the wind's from about, or let's say about sort of 100 true wind angle up to maybe about 45, we can get her steering herself, so we don't have to steer. Anything lower than about 100, you've got to steer it. She'll go all over the place. But, if you ideally have been reached, you know, we've had 36 hours where we haven't touched the helm. Should just steer.
Well, that's a beautiful balance.
Yeah. When you get it right, it's absolutely lovely. Yeah. Really nice. So we've never had auto helm. She doesn't have hot water. She doesn't have any pressurized water. You know, it's a very, very simple boat technically, mm-hmm. which sort of we really tried to keep it that way. You know, it's literally just, you know, a house battery and an engine battery and whatever you can run off that. We have one little solar panel just that when we're at anchor and stuff, we put out. But we don't draw much power. We've got a fridge that hardly use. So we're trying to keep it very different from being at home, because I sort of struggle to understand people who buy boats that are trying to make them like their homes. You might as well just stay at home.
Yeah.
Or build a house with a view or something. I don't know.
Yeah.
I like it to be a different experience. And I'm not saying I like it to be particularly uncomfortable. It's not uncomfortable, but it's a different feeling sailing an old boat, and keeping in touch with the reasons why you sail an old boat is important. Not making it, a pseudo modern boat, I think, is important.
And also, it's almost closer to going away camping on water than going away to a waterfront apartment, right?
Exactly.
And we know with our kids were sailing, and the nights you spend with hot chocolates and playing cards, and no technology, no television, just disconnected from the world. But equally, the time you spend maintaining your boat, the more systems you have, the more stuff you got to service, the more stuff breaks and goes wrong. And simple's good.
Yeah, no, we try and keep it simple. In fact, I remember, when our kids were little, we used to have the rule on the boat that mum and dad weren't allowed to tell them to turn their lights off to stop reading. Mm-hmm. At home, you could say, go to bed. But on the boat, we weren't allowed to say, you've got to stop reading now, which was just the best thing, because they'd be absolutely exhausted. They'd start reading and they'd fall asleep straight away. But it's that sort of reverse psychology of saying, you're on the boat, you don't have to, there's no rules here.
Yeah.
And in those days, there was no internet or anything, so the fun you made was whatever you did, and which we used to really enjoy. So we got back to Melbourne. There were a few issues with the boat. She was starting to leak because of this issue with the carvel planking. So after a couple of years, I made the commitment to re-plank her.
Wow.
which was sort of. Actually, I've got ahead of myself here. I'm going to recap that, because I've got this the wrong way around. We started dealing with the deck. The deck was okay, but it's getting a bit thin. So because it was probably 40 years old. And it was just teak with no underlay to it. In those days, they just butted up, and then the seams caulked with sort of an old fashioned type sicker stuff. So that started to leak. So we changed the decks first and did a little bit of reorganizing down below. We moved to fridge so we could have a slightly bigger chart table and things like that. While the deck was off, that was quite an easy thing to do. And we re-engined her as well, because she had the original, it wasn't the original, actually, it was the second engine. The first on the plans, it's drawn as something called a Grey 4, which I think was a petrol engine originally,
right?
Which we never saw. And then when I got her, she had a Perkins in her, which was nearing the end of her life. And we put a Volvo in when the deck was off. And redid the cockpit and stuff. So that was the first stage of major restorations. There's two stages. That was the first stage, which was really good. We did that here in Melbourne, and she was looking pretty special after that. And then we decided, in between these things, I think we went up to Hamilton Island. We did Hamilton Island Race Week 1 year. So that was a up the coast. We took her up and back, and we went... Did we go over to Tassie? Yeah, we went over to Tassie as well, down to the wooden boat show in Hobart during that time as well. And then we decided that we wanted to go back to New Zealand, because New Zealand's the best place in the world to go sailing.
It's pretty special, that's for sure. Down to the Hauraki Gulf. Okay,
whereabouts are you from?
So I'm from Blenheim originally, which is Marlborough Town.
Yeah.
I've spent most of my life in Auckland, and when I bought my yacht, I bought an Auckland Star with, and we spent the first 2 summers just cruising from Tauranga, the Hauraki Gulf, out to Great Barrier Island and all the way up to Bale Island. So it's a special cruising area there.
Yeah, really special. I mean, I love it, because it's sort of safe enough that you can avoid getting into trouble if you're conscientious and you think about it, but it's also challenging enough that you can do stuff that's relatively difficult. Like sailing in the Whitsundays is just boring, because it's just like nowhere to go. Like everything's 3 miles away and crowded and all that sort of stuff. I just love it. I think it's a great area to sail. So anyway, we decided to sail her back to Auckland. We took her up to Brisbane first. I can't remember why, but we left from Brisbane. Mm-hmm. We had the most beautiful sail across to, I think we did it in 6.5 days from Brisbane to the top of New Zealand. The whole thing on a port tack, absolutely one tack the whole way.
Yeah.
Caught fish. It was warm.
Yeah.
Rain. Yeah. The dream passage, that one. But the boat was starting to take a bit of water. And then we, the top of the North Island, we jibed, ran down the coast. So, and caught a couple of absolutely beautiful, what do you call them in New Zealand? You call them?
Kawai.
Trevally,
Kawai.
Spanish mackerel, do you call them something else? I think, I think there's a Maori name for them. Anyway, you know, caught those on the way down and just had the most beautiful trip. But when we got to Auckland and we were being looked after by the Classic Yacht Association in New Zealand in terms of they were helping us with berthing and things like that. So we actually stopped in Viaduct and, you know, the boat was starting to really open up. There was quite a lot of water coming in. And we sailed that summer over in New Zealand, and then I decided at that stage the dollar was relatively favourable for an Australian, so we decided to get the work done on the hull in New Zealand by a guy called Phil Bish, who put her in a shed. I can't even remember where it is. I'll remember in a minute. And his idea was to remove the planking, keep the frames, remove the planking so we wouldn't have to pull out all the furniture and everything, so taking off the original mahogany. And we put carry on the outside, so she's now carry planked, which is
You did remove both layers, and both layers were outside of the frames, and everything else set inside the frames. Is that how that sort of...
Yeah, so basically it was important that we didn't like take all the planking off and then put a whole lot on, start at one end and literally start working down the boat so we keep the shape of the boat.
Yeah.
He was amazingly skilled. Like, I think the level of workmanship, I mean, there's a couple of really good shipwrights here in Melbourne, but... You know, just generally the understanding and the approach to boat building in New Zealand is just so much deeper than it is here, especially in Melbourne.
Yeah.
And people in Melbourne are great at racing around in little triangles and stuff like that. But in terms of sort of a deeper sort of cultural understanding of sailing, you know, I think New Zealand is, you know, the place to go. And Phil was fantastic in what he did for the boat. So now she's still got her 8 frames, but she's carry planks through the whole thing and pretty much watertight and has been for sort of 10 years. So,
just like this, another whole
that was a major commitment. But you know, it was in a shed for maybe 6 months or something like that doing that. But you know, it's probably prolonged her life, you know, another 50 years in doing it.
Yeah, massively. So. And carries a good material, strong, warm.
Exactly. And they love working with it. The shipwrights love working with it. But you know, I suppose when you add up the work we've done on the deck and then the work we've done on the hull and the engine and all the other stuff that goes in between, I could probably have myself a, you know, a nice sort of 5-year-old Swan 48 or something for the cost of
I have a similar, probably actually probably not as bad as yours, but I suddenly spent more of my 20-odd-year-old Beneteau than I spent buying it. And I've had to keep it for, you know, 9 years to get some of the value back. But yeah, there's nothing scientific or economical about it. It turns into a labor of love that just never ends.
Exactly. And there's a couple of ways to look at it. I mean, I think the scale that doesn't get used enough is the cost per mile sailed. So the best way to bring that down is to sail more miles.
So true.
So the most expensive boats are the ones that never go out because your cost per mile is really high, especially if, you know, if you've only done 50 miles for the year, it's going to be expensive. So I think cost per mile is a good way of looking at it, I think. Yeah.
Yeah. That's good. That's going to help me a lot at home. I can see that now. The dollar a mile last year.
Not bad. Exactly. Well, that's how you need to look at it. That's exactly how you need to look at it. And then you can have all these sort of esoteric arguments about, you know, it's just a custodianship for another generation or whatever, you know, which is sort of true. I like to think that, you know, you're really just preserving something for somebody else to look after as well and keep a bit of history going, keep a bit of, and you know, at the end of the day, you're lucky if a classic boat is worth what you spent on it. I mean, it's certainly not got any other value. You know, like if somebody says there's a bargain in a wooden boat, there's not.
No.
You know, it's basically worth zero, and then whatever you spend on it, it might be worth if you're lucky.
Yeah. Not to mention the others that you don't put a price on sometimes.
Exactly. We're actually, just as a sideline, three of the guys who I did that 50 Sydney Hobart with, so that's 26, 7 years ago, three of them sail with me regularly still. But we're also got this mad little syndicate where we're restoring a boat called Yvonne, which is a Tamlaren, which is a double-ended Knud Rima's design from 1937. And in Melbourne, this boat called Yvonne is probably the most successful ever keelboat on Port Phillip Bay. She won everything for about 40 years. And we found her in a shed in Adelaide and we brought her over here. And every Friday we try and get together and work on her. And we're doing really well. We've reframed her and we've got the decks on. And, you know, next year she'll be back in the water. Wow. But if you think of the hours we put into that, she's probably worth... This is an engineless day sailing 28-foot wooden boat. You know, it's just a one design. But, you know, like even at $30 an hour, I think we did the calculations, is well over $500,000. So you just don't want to think about that stuff, you know. It's,
well, that's a real passion, though, isn't it? I mean, it's surreal. I mean,
for us, it's a community as well, you know.
It was in terms of preserving something for the future that you get a whole new life out of.
Yeah, and it's a chance to catch up with your friends and do something like-minded and, you know that it's worthwhile and, you know, and you know we're not in a rush to do it, but it's a good chance to sort of to do something that sort of you feel is preserving a little bit of history and doing it the right way. So anyway, that's Yvonne as a sideline. That's a little, I can send you some pictures of that because it's quite a cool little project, which is over at Williamstown. So where do we get to? Yeah, so we restored the boat pretty much to how she is now in New Zealand, and then we took her up to New Caledonia and Vanuatu. And had a horrendous trip up to Vanuatu. I thought that was going to be the nice bit, but it was windy, really windy. Not necessarily beating, but we had, you know, 30, 40 knots for 3 or 4 days with lots of rain. And
yeah,
on an old wooden boat like that, nothing stays dry. You know, you're just wet.
That's hard work downstairs. Yeah. And was that with family or your crew or both?
No, that's with... Generally, what we've been doing is I've got a group of, like, 4 or 5 mates who go back to those early racing days, who we'd sort of do the longer deliveries because we're hand steering and it's a bit more rugged. And then when we get there, we spend time with the family. Mind you, my son's now, you know, mid-20s, and he's coming along with us on the passages as well. And actually my wife, who Kylie sails with, she's got a Sydney 38. So she races out here in Melbourne with Kylie and a group of other people.
Called No Man's Land, I think.
That's it. That's the one. You know about it. No Man's Land. So she's really into the racing and mm-hmm. you know, going around in triangles down here. And they were aiming for the Women's Keelback Regatta, which got canned like everything else. So they're sort of a bit on hold here at the moment. We're not really, we haven't had any racing yet at all. So we're still...
You haven't restarted yet. Your coronavirus new spikes probably aren't going to help the cause.
Exactly. So I think the latest, I think it's the 23rd of July, was meant to be the first race, but I think even that might get pushed back now. So
yeah, right. Oh, that's so, yeah. That's makes it a weird old year, doesn't it?
Absolutely. In fact, sort of skipping it a little bit ahead there. Earlier this year, we were planning to go back to New Zealand and leave in February, and that all obviously got put on hold with what happened. I'll leave at the end of February, but we sort of put that on hold with what was happening. And we thought, never mind, we'll just go in the spring. So we're taking the boat up to Sydney so we could leave from Sydney. We thought, never mind, we'll go in November. But even now, looking at what's going on, you know, whether we're going to be allowed to sail to New Zealand in November is not certain by any means, you know.
Yeah.
A month ago, I was thinking, yeah, for sure we'll be able to, you know, the New Zealand bubble will be open and we'll be able to do it, but I'm sort of not so confident anymore.
Yeah, I agree. It was all looking pretty good for somewhere between July and September, and then with this sort of flare up in Melbourne, it sort of put it back a bit, and New Zealand's not really clear as to whether they're going to open it up to states one at a time or whether they're waiting for the whole national situation.
And how you even do that, you know?
I think they'll wait, because otherwise you just drive from Victoria to New South Wales and fly out there anyway, right? How do you police
that?
So
yeah. I mean, the trip will take us 7 or 8 days. So, you know, there probably won't be the system in place, but you could easily sail and then agree to isolate for a week on the boat when you got there or something. They probably won't allow that.
Yeah, they happened to be in March where they brought the quarantine in when we were halfway across the town.
That's right. I heard your podcast about that. Yeah.
About the picture. So we counted the 10 days and then we just had to stay off for 4 days when we got there before we could come into a marina. So arguably you could just sail a bit slower or, you know, And as long as you've been quarantined for 14 days, you're kind of done, really. So it's not too bad if you time it right.
Yeah, yeah. I'd be interesting to know whether that's a genuine option as well.
It is now. Even for merchant ships, they say if a merchant ship has been at sea for at least 14 days, I think, that there's no quarantine required on arrival, as long as they get a doctor to check out the crew and take temperatures and stuff like that.
Yeah, and do that sort of thing. Because, there's no reason you couldn't sail to New Zealand or, spend a couple of days on board before you left.
Yeah.
Sail to New Zealand, say 7 or 8 days, and then put the pick down in the Bay of Ireland somewhere and sit around and go for a swim and finish off the beer and go in.
Yeah, it's just historically except that issue of anchoring before you hit the customs docks. Normally not, it's been a no-no, so I'm not sure how they...
Even anchoring?
Oh, yeah, normally. Like, if you come into Australia and you anchor before you go to the Q dock, it's a $50,000 fine.
Is that anchoring? Are you talking about anchoring not going ashore, though?
Correct.
Just putting the pick down. Is that right?
Yep. Unless you can claim an emergency and you get there and you let them know in advance. But if you come into contact with another boat or anchor, and it's the same that once you clear out, you've got to go. You're not allowed to anchor inside of international waters.
Okay, well, that makes it a bit harder, doesn't it? Yeah, I didn't realize that. I thought you were allowed to anchor off and not speak to anyone.
No, well, however, with the coronavirus, I think there's all sorts of exceptions because you can only do what you can, right? You can't stay at sea forever either. Subject to food and water, but yeah. You just get a good weather window and sail slower. Fill up your 4 days.
Yeah. No, that's interesting.
Okay.
So where was I? So getting back to Fairwinds, So nowadays, we do these ocean trips, not all the time, but maybe every few years we try and get away. This leg to New Zealand that we were planning is planning to be the first leg of a bigger Pacific Triangle, which we're sort of planning to do over 2 years. So we're planning to go to Auckland this spring, have the summer in Auckland, then do the classic up to Tonga and then cross to Fiji and then back to Vanuatu and Solomons and then back through the Louisiades through PNG and back to Cairns was the sort of the idea to do that over 2 winters and sort of tuck the boat away as safely as possible somewhere in the cyclone season and leave it. So we're sort of, that's our big plan at the moment, but it's just sort of depends on, whether we're allowed to get started. I was actually chatting with Ant, one of the guys who sails with me last night, and we were looking at plan Bs. Maybe we have to sail around Australia instead. I mean, if you can't go anywhere else, you might as well. There's plenty to see here.
Well, that's right. There is plenty to see, but it's inconvenient, isn't it? I mean, there's lots of sailors on the road right now that are stuck where they are, whether they want to be there or not, because they can't. No one else will take them if they leave. So,
exactly. Exactly.
So, yeah. How long have you got before you make a kind of a decision on that?
Yeah. Well, we just started July now. I mean, we'd need to go probably November, so that's 5 months away.
Yeah.
I mean, we had thought, do we go up and do Hamilton Island Race Week again? But it's sort of quite a long way to go. It's 2 weeks sail, 10-day sail for us to get up there from Sydney, where the boat is now.
Yeah.
So we're thinking about doing that. But, things like that, just doing them the last minute aren't really as satisfying as looking forward to them and planning them and doing them really properly and, making sure you've got somewhere nice to stay and all your friends there and, so we probably won't do that. So what else was I going to say about the boat? Because I sort of just probably skipped over a whole lot of stuff there. So nowadays she's pretty solid. She's watertight and in fairly good nick. There's always things that need tidying up, and we really do rely on the crew a lot to help me. It's almost, it really is as much their boat as it is mine. There's sort of 4 other guys who, just give so much time, not only sailing, but just preparing her, looking after them. One of them's, really good at the woodwork. Another guy's an electrician, so he helps me with that. And then the other guy's just, there whenever you want to, slip the boat, anti-foul the boat, organize stuff. So I really relied on having a really good core of people. And I think that's one of the things that's one of the first things I'd sort of say to people who, want to get into a sort of more serious cruising mode with their boats is just building a sort of small database of people who you can really rely on and who really want to be involved. You don't want to be asking favors, thinking that people don't really want to do it. Calling in the favors all the time. So I've been very lucky in that respect. And, you know, although I sort of paid the majority of the bills, I just certainly could not do it without a group of people who really, who really put in. And, you know, they get to go sailing, get to have a lot of fun, have a lot of fun on the boat. But it is pretty special the way that this sort of group of people from, 30 years ago when we first started sailing is still sailing together.
Wow.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's a great story. I mean, my sailing with a crew experience goes back to 2014, so only 6 years. And so I've got a smaller story than you, but I have had a core group that's come along over that time and a core cluster of maybe six or eight that are always there and always put their hand up and go out of the way to help with stuff. And whenever we have a working beer, they come down, and I couldn't do it without that. And I think it's easy if you're a boat owner it's not about not asking for enough, but not, it's easy to actually undervalue the value they place on being part of your crew Yeah, and you almost feel guilty for asking them, but sometimes when you hear them talking about it to other people, like, oh, this is the yacht we sail on, they really take ownership. Yeah. And so I think it's good to hear your story and your example because...
I totally agree with that. In fact, a little while ago, I slipped the boat and it was on a Tuesday morning and I thought, oh, I can do it myself. It's not too windy. I can get the boat into the cradle and into the travel lift and do it myself. And then one of the guys said, why didn't you ask me? Didn't you want me to help you? And I went, I just didn't really feel comfortable asking because I love doing stuff like that. You know, why didn't you ask me? And I was only not asking because I felt like I was, taking up people's time.
We're still all big Boy Scouts at heart and, loving anything related to boats and water, swinging a hammer or what have you.
Exactly. And, big machines, pulling the boat out and doing all that and, chatting to people and go and get a coffee afterwards. It's all part of the sort of the way that it works. I should probably without wanting to spruik anything, but maybe talk a little bit about the classic yachting scene down here in Melbourne.
That'd be good because I was going to ask you about, you kind of stumbled into this, what's potentially been a 25-year love affair with wooden boats and then taking quite a big role in the Wooden Boat Association. So it'd be good for you to talk a little bit about that because I think a lot of people occasionally see a cluster of wooden boats together, and I have in Tasmania recently it was back in February for something, and they looked stunning.
It was the Australian Wooden Boat Festival, I think.
It was a three-day regatta. We were down in not in Hobart, but the anchorage before Hobart for the night.
Kettering.
Kettering. And there's all these wooden boats there, and they've been racing, and I took some great photos. It just looks stunning. But I've always admired from afar the love affair and passion that wooden boat owners have for their boats. And it's almost like they're maintaining these pieces of art, really. They've got a lot of respect for the hours and workmanship that goes into them. And even right down to some of them, when you look at how much work it takes to rig them up and de-rig them after sailing just to go out for the day. We unfurl a Gennaro on a cruising boat and pull up the main and away we go. I don't even think about that stuff anymore,
That's true.
To hear more about that, Mark.
Yeah, I think there's a few things that sort of you've triggered me thinking about saying that. I mean, beautiful concourse, standard, elegant wooden boats are stunning, But I think we've got to be careful that's not what we're really sort of aspiring to here. I think what we're really aspiring to is people using the wooden boats, actually getting out there using them. My boat's got, I think we've got the three hatches that we varnish, the boom crutch we varnish, and the tiller, and that's it. I won't have any more varnish on the boat just because I prefer to go sailing than varnishing. And that sort of attitude, it's fine if people want to sit and varnish their boats. I don't have a problem with it, but I'm far more interested in getting people using their boats because the best way to maintain a boat is to use it, is to keep it alive, it's to actually get out there and start sailing it, and then you're starting to fix it, and then you're thinking about how to make it better and looking after it and all that sort of stuff. So I'm a little bit we've got a couple of big glamour boats down here in Melbourne. There's a boat called Sayonara, which is a Fife design gaff cutter from 1898 or 1896 or something, so she's 120 years old, and she's normally in immaculate condition. And, you know, she's owned by a syndicate and they get out and not enough, you know, doesn't go out enough. And, you know, they'll complain that they have to spend a whole lot of money to be part of the syndicate and they don't really get enough sailing and you know, that's one thing. But I would prefer to, well, not prefer, but I'm sort of more interested in the guy who's bought a little 30 footer with a sort of interesting provenance and he's worked out that he can, you know, varnish the mast himself and a couple of mates helped him take it out. And then they got together and they, you know, put in for a suit of sails. And that sort of community type sailing is really where the grassroots lies, I think, and where the sort of future for wooden boats lie. I mean, you know, we've all seen the pictures in Monaco of the rows and rows of, you know, the glamour boats. And that's one thing, but it's sort of not really where we're at here in Australia.
I completely agree. Boats are made to be used. And I'd rather people be on the water in a state of disrepair with a list of endless maintenance than a museum piece sitting in the marina.
And they're more likely to get things fixed, you know, if they're
sailing. That's right.
There's an imperative to fix it if you're sailing.
It might not work out reminding you.
Just as a sort of reflection on that a little bit, I'd run the Instagram feed for the Classic Yacht Association. And it's interesting when we were up on Pittwater a little while ago. And, you know, I just took a picture of a little boat. I don't even know what it was. It was sitting on its mooring looking a bit sad, but it was a cute boat, probably about 25 foot and all the paint was peeling off it. And I just made some comment about, you know, what do you reckon about these? Do you think it should have a bowsprit? You know, what could you do with it? And just the comments, the engagement from this one photograph of this little old boat, you know, it was like sort of 50 comments and, you know, 800 likes, which I'd never get at all. And then if I post a picture of Sayonara, the glamour boat down here going along gaff cutter with a topsail up and, you know, people will like it, but you don't get any engagement with it. You know, people can see it and go, oh, that's nice, but it's not me.
Yeah.
When they saw this little old boat with the paint peeling off, they thought, oh, I could have that. I could do something with
it. Yeah, that's right.
You know, so that's sort of trying to get in on a place where people, you know, believe it could be part of their lives, I think is a really interesting way to grow classic yachting. And, you know, of course there's more work. And of course, you know, it's not as simple as buying a, you know, a 30 foot Hansi and just going off, you know, wherever you want to go or whatever. But I think the rewards are proportional. You know, I really do believe that. And it doesn't have to be massively expensive. And your boat doesn't have to look absolutely beautiful. You know, we have this thing called the two chain rule, which is that it has to look good from two chains. And a cricket pitch is a chain, 22 yards. So 44 yards away, if your boat looks good from 44 yards away, that's fine. We call it the two chain rule. So don't come any closer than that. And if it looks good, then that's fine. So down here in Melbourne, the Classic Yacht Association down here, normally in a normal year would run a winter series and a summer series, which the summer series is probably 3 times a month and the winter series would be 2 times a month.
Okay.
And it's run on a Sunday, usually Sunday sort of 11 o'clock start or 10:30 start. And in the summer, you might get 20 or 30 boats out, in the winter, probably about 15 to 20.
Oh, that's good fleet.
And then, yeah, really good fleet. It's a really good fleet. And so eclectic, you know, like we have Cooter boats, we have the Tumlarans, we have a whole range of sort of mid-sized keel boats, sort of 30 to 40 foot of keel boats. We have the big glamour boats, Sanara, Acrospire. They're the big sort of, you know, 100-year-old gaff cutters that race with us. And and there's just a whole lot of crazy stuff in between. You know, we're not, you know, although it's called the Classic Yacht Association, if you want to sail with us, you can, you know, if you feel like you want to, that's great. And that racing's really good. It's relatively competitive. You know, I believe that if you're going to be out there racing, you might as well try and go as fast as you can. You know, we really emphasize trying not to crash into other boats, because, you know, it's one thing crashing into another boat in a plastic boat, but in a wooden boat, it's sort of just the consequences are a bit bigger.
Yeah.
In terms of repair costs and all that sort of thing. And we have had a few incidents, but, you know, we try and be really diplomatic about it and try and encourage people, even if, you know, they're not feeling comfortable, maybe just start a minute behind everybody else and then get the idea and that sort of thing. And so we're fairly competitive. You know, it's all performance handicap. So golf handicap, you know, you do better, you get punished more and that sort of thing.
Yeah.
And then over Melbourne Cup weekend, November 1st, we end in November, basically, we have what we call the Cup Regatta, which is our one big event of the year, which is now, I think, being us, I was the president of the association when we started it, and I think it was like 13, 14 years ago. And we have an exchange with the New Zealand Classic Yacht Association. They usually get about 15, 20 people come over and sail on our boats, and then we go and sail in the Anniversary Day Regatta or Maharangi Regatta over there. So we sort of have an exchange, and for that we've had up to 40 boats entered in that. Wow. And it's over 3 days over the Cup weekend, so it's a Saturday, Sunday, Monday racing. And then Tuesday's Cup day, so people take the Monday off work is the idea. It's Saturday, Sunday, take the Monday off work, and then Tuesday's Cup day to recover, or if you've come from interstate, whatever you want to do. And that's a fantastic event. It's highly social, lots of sailing. We sail, I think we sail five races over the 3 days and finish with a great big pursuit race. And so it's really what sailing should be about for me, that sort of thing, you know, like you try hard, but at the end of the day, it just doesn't matter, you know, you just sort of enjoy it. So that's the sort of story in Victoria. Is run, the Classic Yacht Association runs most of the events.
Just a question, do they run it out of their own club, or is there another club they run that out of?
Well, the association is its own thing, and what we do is we get the clubs to run the races, but we'll move it around three or four yacht clubs so everybody gets a turn. And at the top end of the bay here, everything's within about 5 or 6 miles of each other, so it's not a huge deal having to go to another yacht club. The reason we get the yacht clubs to run it is A, they've got the infrastructure and the knowledge, and B, I think there's an insurance thing to do with that as well. So if the yacht club's running the race, then they're covered for doing it the right way or whatever. So it's run from different yacht clubs, but under the auspices of the Classic Yacht Association.
What's the best way to find out more information about the Classic Yacht Association itself, or the Woodboat Association itself?
Website. So that would be the website. So classic-yacht.asn.au. So okay. I can shoot that through to you if you want.
And also,
I might shoot you a bit of background stuff that if you
background for any photos, I'll share those in the
I'll bore you to death with stuff afterwards.
That's cool, love that stuff. That'll be great. And I'll link to it off the website as well. So anything please do that.
Mark. Just briefly, in Sydney with the wooden boats, it's a little bit harder to get a sort of quorum of interest, because so many people keep their boats on a mooring at the bottom of the garden, or, you know, and there's so many different coves, and whether it's on Pittwater or the harbour or wherever. So it's harder to get the boats together. Sydney Amateur Sailing Club in Manly, in Mossman, is, you know, probably the hub of where you'd go to sail on wooden boats. And there's always people looking for crew on wooden boats. And they do obviously have some regattas, but it's more of a environment where people are sort of sailing their own boats recreationally for fun, and, you know, just sort of cruising them around the harbour. So the association is there, and it's got a presence, and, you know, we contribute to the regattas and things, but it's less of a hub of interest.
Yeah, that makes sense. Okay.
And then I suppose the other, you know, big thing in terms of the wooden boats is the Wooden Boat Festival, the Australian Wooden Boat Festival, which is in Hobart, which is every other year. So next year is an on year, so 2001. So it's every odd year in Hobart. And that is, I don't know, have you ever been to that?
No, I have seen a Wooden Boat Festival in Auckland at one stage a long time ago. All I remember is 30 or 40 stunning boats tied up in the viaduct, but that was a long time ago now. I haven't been there in Australia.
No, so the Australian Wooden Boat Festival is something that you should definitely, definitely have on your bucket list. Last year, we went down last year, so 2019, we went down, and it's in end of February, beginning of March, I think. And they'll have maybe about 60 or 70 boats on the water from all around Australia, from Queensland, New South Wales, lots from Tassie, lots from Victoria, some from South Australia. People sail over from New Zealand for it. And they're all tied up together, and it is the most magical atmosphere. And then on top of that, there's a huge suite of shoreside activities as well. You know, skills, traditional skills. They have a whole symposium of people talking about design. They have a whole sort of food festival alongside it. So the 3 days of that is, I think in terms of tourism for Tasmania, it's one of the biggest events in terms of incoming inbound passenger or holiday makers or whatever you want to say, who come for that. So that's on odd years biennially.
February 2021, is it?
2021 will be the next one, yeah. And yeah, if you just put Australian Wooden Boat Festival into a search engine, you'll get the detail on that. But I mean, that is a one-off event, and I'm sort of maybe getting a bit involved with that at the moment. And we're trying to make it a little bit more of a sailing event rather than a walking around admiring the boats event. Mm-hmm. And there's a bit of a sort of logistical issue with that because you have to get all these boats into the marina and into Constitution Dock. Yeah. And then get them all out again and then all back in again is actually quite hard. So you don't want to be doing it twice a day. You know, I think they find it stressful enough doing it once at the beginning of the festival. but we're trying to get it, I think, maybe more as a bit more sailing in the event. But it is seriously a beautiful time to be in Hobart, and Hobart usually just sort of turns it on for that. So, yeah.
Yeah, well, that's good to know. It really is. And, yeah, and those boats, I mean, they just look fantastic on the water. They really do.
Yeah, yep.
And sizes. Yep.
I'll send you some pictures of that as well.
Yeah, that would be great. Anything you can send me, I will share. That would be great.
Excellent. Is there anything else you want me to crap on about?
Well, I mean, it's just fascinating, Mark, and reading about your background. There's a lot of depth in, you know, quite a few chapters, really. But I mean, well, if you look back over the last 25 years. You look at where you are today with you know, Fairwinds. I mean, it's a pretty rich sort of quarter of a century, and you know, probably, I don't know, half your life maybe. I mean, well, I guess the question is, what have you really taken out of that, or what have you learned as a result of all of that, really? What would you carry forth for the rest of your life?
That
was a part of my life that was just fantastic for these reasons.
Yeah. I mean, it's hard not to sort of sink into cliche here, but it is about the connections you make with people, because at the end of the day, you know, the boat's just a boat, and, you know, there's lots of them out there, and if something really bad happened, as long as everybody was okay, it wouldn't matter. Like, I really would not care, you know. So the reason you do it is for the connections and the attitudes involved with sailing, and that's across a whole lot of things. You know, we've talked a little bit about the sort of the preservation of the boats and the importance of maintaining the historical context. So those sort of attitudes are important, but also a sort of what I love is the sort of self-reliance of it, especially with the wooden boats, that we don't expect to be, you know, we're responsible for our own destinies a bit, you know, especially with the ocean passengers. You know, that time we sailed from Auckland up to New Caledonia, and because the boat had been refitted, we had a problem with the rudder, and we started getting water in through the rudder shaft, and, you know, the boat was filling up with water, and it was just a case of tightening down the packing case to actually stop it leaking. But because it was really rough and everyone was feeling sick and nobody really felt like doing it and all that sort of thing, we actually had a lot of water in the boat, and we were exactly halfway between Auckland and Noumea. And, you know, those sort of moments at the time, you think, you know, I said to everybody, okay, we better get up and we better put our wet weather gear on, and we better put our PFDs on, and we better go and sit on deck until we work out what's going on here, because we've got a lot of water in the boat.
Yeah.
And those sort of things, I remember at the time thinking how liberating it was that we couldn't do anything apart from deal with the issue. Yeah. You know, there was no point in calling a helicopter because there was no helicopter that could get there. You know, you could maybe have tried and found a ship to come and, you know, but it was far more practical to actually deal with the issues you were creating yourself. And I think that sort of self-reliance is part of the thing that I've taken out of sailing, is that you don't look for excuses about why things go wrong. You know, you make your own luck and you take the consequences with whatever you do. And I think that's a big thing that I've learned. And that's sort of related to the people I sail with. They've sort of showed me that probably more than I would have done by myself. You know, a couple of them are, you know, just really practical people, you know, who just, you know, when there's an issue, just deal with it, you know,
very
unemotionally, just get on with it. And actually, you know, the podcast you made about your trip over to New Zealand, I mean, it sounds like you had a couple of people on board like that as well.
That's true, though. And you and like, you're all in it together, and it doesn't matter what's caused it, you sort of deal with it, and nobody can get off and pick up their toys and go home. Yeah. There's nowhere else to go but to fix it or deal with it. And
there's no point in complaining this is shit because it doesn't sort of do anything, you know. Yeah. And I really love that about sailing. I love the fact that you do make your own luck, and the rewards from dealing with it are proportionally great. In that, you know, when you must have been very satisfied after that trip that you'd managed it, you know, despite all the shit things that happened, you managed it in a way that I'm not saying felt proud of, but you didn't fuck up anything. You didn't embarrass anybody, or you did exactly what you meant to do, and you did it right, and you got out of it, and no one died, and that was good. You know, that's quite rewarding. You know,
I was. Yeah, you know, it's interesting because you're doing it with mixed feelings at the end. Some relief, but a lot of pride, but mostly in how the crew all conducted themselves individually and with the crew, and truly, it was a team effort. No one had all the answers, or even knew where to start, but collectively. And so it was one of those experiences where at the time you think, gee, these guys are having a bit of a rough trip, and I bet you they wish they could just get off. Mm. But it was funny when we reflected, you know, 4 or 5 weeks later when the dust all settled, they said, you know, I got so much more out of it than I expected. Sure, I wouldn't have chosen to have those challenges.
But
I learned a lot and got a lot out of it. And so, that's right. I mean, a guy I trained with once said that, you know, once you leave the coast, you're master under God. There's just you and the stars and the out there. And
there's very few places where that can happen anymore. And, you know, even, you know, sailing to New Zealand now, that's sort of encroaching on us, you know. I suppose we'll probably, we've got an Iridium Go. So, you know, we'll probably get text messages now and then, but I'll try and avoid doing it. You know, one of my rules on the boat is, you know, we will never, ever, ever have a plotter in the cockpit, you know, because I can't stand people sailing the boat looking at a plotter. Look around you. This is what, if you want to know where you are, make the effort, go downstairs and have a look at the plotter and you can find out where you are. Sailing looking at a plotter is one of my pet hates. And if you really are motoring up a channel and you want to know which side, then you can hold your phone and have a look at it. You know, I understand that, but I refuse to install a plotter in the cockpit because you just sail along staring at it.
And it's
horrible.
especially at night. They're staring like they're playing a PlayStation game as opposed to actually keeping a good lookout,
feeling the wind and how cheesy is it to say, you know, put a star in the crosstrees, you know? But boy, it works, you know, like if you're steering along and there's a star that you can put line up with a stay, then, you know, do that. You sail so much better than staring at the plotter.
And you feel better too if you've got your eyes out of the boat.
Yeah, exactly. And you feel the wind and you feel how the boat's moving better and all that sort of stuff. So I think, you know, getting back to sort of, we got there from that idea of not, of being self-sufficient, but, you know, in a way that's tied in with the classic yacht sailing in that, you know, we try to keep it relatively minimal and, you know, relatively low tech without being unsafe. You know, I'm not about to, you know, say, oh, we all have to use cotton sails and, you know, throw the GPS overboard. It's not like that at all, but try and stay in touch with why you're sailing these boats rather than, you know, a big modern boat. And hopefully the sort of people who understand that, you know, will enjoy the rewards of doing it as well. And some people don't understand it, and that's fine. You know, like, I'm not saying everybody should be like that. I'm just sort of saying that's how we are a bit.
Yeah, and I mean, with anything you immerse yourself into and have to actively engage doing it, you get so much more out of it.
Yeah,
that's for sure. And particularly when you have to think and make decisions.
And I suppose the other thing I would say is that, you know, people say, oh, don't you get, you know, like, so if we do a 150-mile day, that's a good day for us. I mean, it's not an exceptional day. I think our record's like 180 or 185 or something like that. So 150-mile day is a good day. People say, oh, don't you, you know, what's that? So that's 6 knots, okay? People go, don't you get bored just going along 6 knots all the time? Well, you know, sailing boats don't go very fast generally. I mean, apart from the crazy ones we're seeing now. I mean, most sailing boats, I go faster when I get on my bike and go down to the shops. I'm going faster than most sailing boats ever go. You know? So being in it for speed is not really why you're there, unless you're talking about sailing America's Cup boats or something like that, which is something different. But, you know, for all of us who are not sailing foiling boats or, you know, not the absolute latest Edge TP52s or whatever, you're going slower than a bicycle on a normal day. So speed isn't really why you're out there. So there's another reason why you're out there. And for me, it's this sort of combination of attitude and aesthetic as well, in that the boat looks beautiful and the attitudes of the people sailing it are right.
I totally, I mean, it's a real philosophical discussion almost, but I completely agree. And I've never been bored. The backdrop's stunning and it changes daily. And what's the hurry to get there anyway? And, you know,
I mean, we actually get more sailing in because it takes longer.
Well, that's right. And also, so you might spend another 200 grand on a faster boat to go 8 knots instead of 6. Well, it's not that much faster.
And my bike is still faster. My push bike is still going faster than your $500,000 boat.
You get across the Tasman in one day less. Well, so what, you know?
Usually
when you get there, it's over too soon anyway. So I think that's a great way of looking at it. And you know, maybe you need to detune even more from the rat race if you still feel the urgency 3 or 4 days into a passage that you think each for knot or two will make a difference to your experience. But yeah, it's a great way of looking at it. And it is, you know, the more that you sail offshore, the more that it's all about what's the least amount of stuff and the least amount of equipment and the least amount of technology you can take to sea, not what's the most, what's the least safety. But you know, more doesn't equal more. More just makes life harder and busier and boat. You know, there's more stuff to
and
jump
really on. I mean, from a sort of safety point of view, you have to really say, either can I do without it, or B, can I fix it? And if the answer is I can't fix it, but I can't do without it, then you've got a problem. You know, you should sort of, everything you need, you should know how to fix. You know, I can probably do without an engine for a few days, you know, I'll be careful and we'll not run the engine and all that sort of thing. But you know, hot water systems. You know? I don't know how to fix a hot water system.
Yeah.
Hot water system. I know how to boil a kettle if I really want hot water, you know. Sort of.
That's right. Hang a salt bag on your mast and you have hot water at an hour.
Really we do a lot of crazy stuff like that. So.
Yeah.
Yeah. We always do the washing up, the dishes washing up in the cockpit after, in a bucket in the cockpit after. And after 19 years, the bucket, which I actually inherited with the boat, developed a small leak after 18 years. So one of the big acquisitions this year is we bought a new bucket for Fairwind. So that's and choosing the bucket was a big deal. Like, they took hours of discussion to choose what the bucket needed. And there's a lot of requirements in the bucket. It needs to be big enough, but it mustn't have metal handles because they scratch the side of the boat. And it can't rust, so you know, you got to do this. And so we had hours and hours of discussions over, you know, a glass of red wine about what sort of bucket we were looking for, and then we eventually found the perfect bucket. So
And you just touched on an interesting point, because particularly in your case, over the years of sailing with the same people, the same core group at least, develop these kind of norms and cultures and traditions without even thinking about it. Sometimes it's amazing how much the crew take ownership of those norms or traditions, and you hear them explained to other people, or you say, oh, this is how we always do it this way, or do it this way, or this is what we do. And, you know, it's amazing
It's amazing how long you can make it like an in-joke last, how many years you can make it last. There's one guy, Roger, who sails with us. He, early in one passage, did the washing up, and it was very early in the passage, chucked the dirty water overboard with all the forks in it, you know, early on. And so, you know, every time we get on the boat, he gets reminded about how he threw the forks over.
Oh, yeah.
You know, you never get away with stuff like that.
It keeps giving, isn't it, those stories that happen to see. I mean, with Fairwind, other than what you've got ahead of you the next, you know, 2 years, what do you see ahead of you the next 10 years? I mean, clearly with the world right now, that's probably a complicated question, but just in terms of your sailing, your passion, is Fairwind your forever, or your forever yacht?
I think so, I mean, you do think about that. I'm 50, how old am I, 54 now. So, you know, you think about, oh God, you know, in 20 years time, I'm going to be 74. Well, I'm hoping I'd still sail Fairwind when I'm 74, you know. So, I mean, ideally, I'd like to, my son's, you know, loves the boat too. You know, it'd be great to think it could become a hereditary thing where he'll need to earn a certain amount of money to look after it, which there's no guarantee of at the moment. You know, that would be the ideal scenario for me, that it would become something that stayed in the family, you know, and got passed down. It's important enough to me, But I'd hate to him ever to feel pressured for that. I mean, I know he likes the boat. I know he likes sailing.
Yeah.
But I'd have hated ever to be a millstone for him to say, you know, you have to look after the boat. You have to spend all this money on it. You know, it's not that important. Like, you know, you can always,
yeah,
a lot of money selling it, but you can always sell it and, you know, do that. But it would be lovely to think that it did continue in the family. I think that would be the ideal. And, you know, I mean, I suspect, you know, we'd probably be based in Melbourne and it's not the ideal place to be a cruising ground, but, you know, it gives you an excuse to go away, you know, so you're not always here. You know, we've got Tasmania, which is, you know, such a beautiful place to go sailing. You can always go back to Sydney and up the coast and do that sort of thing. And maybe, you know, maybe the longer trips will, you know, reduce in number once, you know, once we get seriously old. But then by then, hopefully my son might be interested in looking after it. And
Yeah.
I mean, I, as I said, I'd never wanted it to be an obligation for him. That would be unfair.
Well, I don't know. Yeah. And I mean, with the, I mean, 19 years and the experiences you must have had as a family, incredible time together that, you know, what else you can do on the planet that's a substitute to spending time together on a yacht.
Yeah.
Like, particularly being self-sufficient for weeks at a time. I mean, you could create some pretty special memories. And, you know, I mean, part of your family, really. It becomes a family member in a crazy
Yeah, no, that's true. I mean, we've got pictures of the kids growing up on the boat. So, you know, they were like sort of 4 or 5 years old when we first got it. And, you know, when we were in New Zealand, you know, pictures of them on the Gulf, you know, lying on the deck, colouring in, colouring books and stuff like that. And, you know, now they're adults who finished university and stuff. So that sort of ongoing history is sort of rewarding without wanting to get too sentimental about it. It's sort of
I haven't thought about this before, but yachts are probably almost like songs where people can hear a song and it'll take them back to a time when they're 16 years old and take them back to that moment. I mean, it's almost like memories from yachts often take you straight back to, you know, what you did that summer for.
Yeah,
you know,
absolutely.
A time
absolutely. It's funny, you know, I to sort of flip that a little bit, I remember the music that we were listening to when we bought the boat and sailed it in the Gulf when we first bought it, you know. So that sort of music sort of ties in as well. It's really rather lovely. I like that.
Yeah.
You could sort of, No, it's really interesting.
Yeah, and it's fascinating. Oh, that's really good, Mark. Well, I mean, is there anything else you want to share?
I think people have probably listened to me enough. I mean, I suppose the only thing, you know, the thing that I'd reiterate is I think that wooden boat sailing or classic yachting, if you want to call it that, I prefer to call it wooden boat sailing because there's always, I've got a friend, Tim Phillips, who runs the wooden boat shop and basically is responsible for the resurgence of cooter boat sailing in Melbourne, you know, which is one of the biggest success stories in wooden boats. And he says, you can't call them yachts because yachts aren't working boats and cooter boats can't sail with yachts. And so I like just to call them wooden boats because a cooter boat isn't a yacht. It's a boat because it's a working boat. Just the same, a pilot cutter isn't a yacht. It's a working boat or, you know, so let's just call them wooden boats. I think you can get it done a bit of a disservice with pushing the sort of glamour angle of them because it puts people off. They think that they're going to be horrendously expensive and they think they're going to be massive amounts of work. And yes, they are going to be some work. And yes, you know, there are going to be costs involved that you might not get on a plastic boat, but it doesn't have to. I prefer to see it as more of a sort of effort reward thing rather than just this sort of aspirational thing that you have to have this perfect classic boat.
Yeah.
It's really just a way of getting out on the water and something that's beautiful and rewarding.
Yeah, I think that's a really, really great way of summarizing it, Mark. I mean, it is about just getting out on the water and going sailing, and the other stuff actually becomes a byproduct of that. The more you sail, the more you have this passion to reinvest time and effort and money into your yacht, and your crew do too. And
yeah,
as much or as little as you want, really. There's no
exactly rules. Exactly, and you know, and the actual introductory number to get a boat isn't a lot. Like I can, you know, there's some boats in Melbourne right now, you know, seriously for $30,000-$40,000 you can get yourself a beautiful wooden boat. I mean, maybe needs a little bit of tidying up, but as solid as a rock, boats that have done 3 or 4 Sydney Hobarts that are still watertight, that you can take out tomorrow, you know. And I don't know what you get for $40,000 in a plastic boat. Maybe you get a 30 foot 20-year-old boat or something. I don't know what you get, so I haven't looked. But for $30,000 or $40,000 here, you can get a really, really lovely wooden boat, which you will need to look after, which will take a bit of work, which you will build a relationship with. And at the end of the day, you know, if you're the right sort of person, you'll be rewarded enormously for it. So the entry level, entry factor isn't necessarily that high. The continuing is probably more of an effort and maybe a little bit more of a cost, but then I'd say the rewards are huge.
Yeah, and I totally agree. And it create memories that you'll treasure for the rest of your life and help shape the lives of your friends and your crew and your family. And you're not going to look back on your deathbed and say, I wish I did less sailing.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly.
And, you know, for the price of a 2 or 3 year old secondhand car.
Yeah, exactly.
$1,000, which we don't think twice about.
Exactly. Yeah.
You know, can just, you know, really shape the rest of your life, really. I've been saying, just puts people from different backgrounds into a common passion and one place together. And many of those people you never meet in any other course of life, but you meet them sailing, you have a common passion, a common bond, and, you know, create a crew of lifelong memories. And, you know, it really is something special.
So. You've hit the nail on the head. You've absolutely hit the nail on the head. I think that sums it up. Yeah.
Yeah, it's good. It's good advice. Well, it's really
lovely to chat. Yeah, really good. I'd love to come for a sail with you one day, or if you're ever in Melbourne, come for a sail with us. Yeah,
that would be great.
Do you get about a bit, or do you get?
I do travel to. Prior to the current situation, I've been down in Sydney reasonably regularly, and the Melbourne every so often. My sister lives in Melbourne, Port Melbourne, so right. I get a bit.
Well, Fairwinds is in Sydney at the moment, so. Next time I'm up there, I'll drop you a line and see if you
can come
for sale on Pittwater and see the boat and
whatever. Oh, I'd love to. And I love Pittwater. It's one of my favourite spots in Australia.
She's anchored in Little Lovett Bay, so just near Scotland Island there at the moment. Not anchored, moored on a mooring there, being waiting. But a mate of mine who sails with us, one of the guys who I've sailed with for years, was up there last week. So the friends go up and use the boat whenever they can, you know, just to keep it dried and aired out. And he said, I don't quite know why you sail in Melbourne. It's so beautiful up here.
Yeah. Oh, the fact that you go sailing is just the best part. You take the weather you're given, right? That's what you do. So.
Yeah, well, I'll drop you a line next time we go up there, because we'll go up for, you know, 10 days or something like that and come and have a sail one afternoon.
Oh, I'd love to. Let's try and line it up. Yeah, I'd love to. That would be great, Mark.
Excellent.
And flick me through an email with any other stuff you want to share.
Yeah, I'll put a whole lot of junk on there, but don't feel like you have to use it.
People love to see
this. Did you put that on the website or something, or on a?
Yeah, so on the Ocean Sailing Podcast website, the podcast area, I'll put the episode and then links to the Wooden Boat Association. And then in the Facebook group, the Ocean Sailing Podcast Facebook group, any media I've got, photos, I'll upload any of their stuff and share them with with people that follow the podcast, so that people who are listening to this, who don't get to watch this, can also go and dive in there and see that as well. So I'll happily share anything and everything. People love to see the story brought to life with any images you have. So
I'll see what I can find. I'll do that this evening anyway.
Okay.
No worries. Lovely to meet you, Doug.
Yeah, you too, Mark. And I look forward to catching up again soon and hopefully going sailing together as well.
That'd be great. I'd enjoy it. Okay, take care.
Take care. You too. Bye.
If you enjoyed this episode with Mark Chew and you'd like to check out a number of photos he supplied me and a couple of videos, go to oceansailingpodcast.com/podcast and you'll find a link off Mark's episode to a dedicated page with all the photos he sent me, which are really fantastic and really highlight the stunning Fairwinds yacht that he currently sails. I'll also post them in the Ocean Sailing Podcast Facebook group as well. Enjoy.
Thanks for listening to another episode of the Ocean Sailing Podcast. Email your comments and suggestions to david@oceansailingpodcast.com.au. See you next week.
If you'd like to find out more about how you can join me on board my yacht for an upcoming expedition, regatta, ocean race, or ocean passage, go to oceansailingpodcast.com and look for the Ocean Sailing Expeditions calendar with a complete list of events right up until the end of 2023 and some really exciting places, destinations, races, and regattas up and down the east coast of Australia, around Tasmania, across the Pacific to Fiji, and also circumnavigations of the North and South Island of New Zealand, along with a New Zealand Southern Islands expedition.
to a different place where love is not illusion based. Fear is just a word they can't define. Where I've heard hope and happiness are found in every beating chest. Cause all those hearts are more or less inclined to give it all away without fear of what's to break. The answer that we never seem to find. The hand we always take disintegrates without a trace. And we're the ones they've always left behind. Help me understand, the best is yet to come. Take me by the hand before I come undone. Cause all this emptiness has left me feeling numb. But it's darkest right before the sun. Moments pass me by, but I refuse to leave my life to fall between the cracks of my control. I was outspoken till I broke open all the chains that were imprisoning my soul. Help me understand, the best is yet to come. Try to swim the other way, then they'll never let you see another day.
But I've been there before, I've been a soldier in this war. If you take it in your stride, you might just see the other side. Just breathe, breathe, cause everything you see is just a storm.
Understand, the best is yet to come. Take me by the hand before I come undone. Cause all